see love as not something that we have and hold, but something that we do. It's a noun. Well, no, it's a verb. And that means that we have to do something. And it doesn't always feel good. And that makes love much tougher. Your co-worker isn't carrying their weight, others are starting to notice, but nobody wants to say anything. So you have to. And that doesn't feel good. Well, your siblings are fighting with one another again. And once again, you have to step out of the safety of the sidelines and be the peacemaker. And that doesn't feel very good. Well, your best friend's in trouble. You've got to walk them through a very difficult season of life. And that's tough. Here's another way to put it. To love humanity is easy. And to love people is great. But when people become a person, it gets tough. To marry someone, stay married. To raise children and not let them drive you crazy. To commit to friendship, to invest in that friendship. They're all tough. Not everybody can do it. That's why we came over. But all this failed in some way from time to time. And as much as we struggle to love the people in our lives, the want to love Jesus raises the standard even more. Because while you're struggling to love your parents and love your spouse and love your siblings, Jesus says, that's not enough. As tough as that is, there's more. He says you have to love your obnoxious mate. You have to love your self-centered students. You have to love the intrusive mother-in-law. And then Jesus says, even that isn't enough. You have to love your persecutors. You have to love your detractors. You have to love your enemies. Talk about tough. So to try and make this series a little more real, we are challenging you to decide who in your life right now, who is that one person that you find tough to love? And maybe over the course of this series, begin to change that. So today I want to drill down a little bit on our motivation to love and what a difference that it makes in our lives and why it matters, even when we don't feel good. I think at least on some level, we don't think that decision and actions and positive steps, the ordinary things that we do to love people, actually really matter. They're not really that important, not really. Sometimes we don't think of them important because they aren't really rewarded. What gets rewarded gets repeated. And the little things that we do to love one another aren't rewarded. Take the Super Bowl last week. Over 100 million watched. But here's my question. How many of those people tuned in because Andy Reid is a good husband and a good father? How many watched because Patrick Mahomes is an active volunteer at the Children's Hospital? How many watched because one of the San Francisco linemen who suffers from a rare disorder counsels other people with that same problem? Now, I'm not against talent. I believe it's essential that we develop our talents. But I don't think anyone's going to tune in to watch a player tucking his kids into bed at night or doing the dishes. His wife, or however he expresses his love in action. Now, I'm not saying that knowing he's a good husband, a good father, that you don't think more highly of him. Of course you do. It's just that people this past week were not talking about Kyle Shanahan's success or failure of loving his kids. Some of us were talking about how the plays he called near the end may have cost them the game. We live in a culture that rewards talent and success and celebrity and money. You don't get rewarded at work for the sacrifices that you make for your family. And I'm not saying you should. But if you go to work and you do a good job, if you're working in the right kind of an environment, it usually brings a bonus or a promotion. You pour energy into work, and at the end, there's a project that you've completed. You have the satisfaction of having completed the project. sometimes, not all that rarely, our very best efforts are received with ingratitude or even ignored entirely. And Jesus speaks exactly to that point in today's gospel. You see, we're in the fifth chapter of Matthew's gospel. This is the portion of the Bible that's commonly referred to as the Sermon on the Mount. And it is, in effect, Jesus' inaugural speech, where he outlines the basics when it comes to being a disciple. The fundamental prohibitions against murder, adultery, judging others, as well as the basic steps towards being a disciple of praying, fasting, giving, and serving. Basically, the sermon encompasses chapters 5, 6, and 7 in Matthew. But you can read the whole thing in about 15 minutes. That's a suggestion, by the way. He's speaking to a crowd of people who are gathered out of curiosity to hear what he has to say. And he had quite a lot to say. And he started with this: "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world." So he calls the people in this crowd salt and light. To us, what's that supposed to mean? Well, light is obviously very basic and important, because when night descended, it also meant security and it meant comfort. And salt was important in that culture and climate before refrigeration, because it was the main method by which food could be kept and preserved. So it was life-sustaining, and it also drove their economy. So if you accepted salt from someone, you were considered in their service. In fact, the word salary comes from the word salt, as people were often paid with it. So salt and light were elements that addressed the quality of life. So basically, Jesus is saying, "I want my disciples to be agents of change, to improve quality of life." And that's why he says, "You're the salt of the earth, you are the light of the world." Now again, he's sitting on a hillside, and he's talking to this crowd of people who are from an obscure village in the backwater of the Roman Empire. They are an audience of illiterate tradesmen and fishermen. And he's telling them this. Two people must have thought, no, we're not. We're nobodies in the middle of nowhere, and we know nothing. But obviously, Jesus sees things differently than they do. And here, he is revealing to them their true identity, their ultimate identity in the sight of heaven. You are the salt, you are the light. And not just the salt and the light, but salt and light for the whole world. Not their little town of Capernaum, not their backwater community of Galilee, not even of their own nation or any single nation, but light and salt for the entire world. That's the plan for his disciples. For us to be these two things, light and salt. So the disciples of Christ are the agents of God's love in the world through our good work. Our good work is the compelling witness of the truth of God. When you act in a certain way, the people of the world notice. And it tends to make the argument for Christianity more convincing and more attractive. One of those things that we emphasize here is being friendly to visitors, greeting them, smiling. Sometimes I get up here, not with you guys, but let's say here and there, and I look out, and instead of seeing the joy of Christ, everybody looks like I'm going to extract a tooth from them. And I think, why do you look like that? I can look like that because I had to be here. So when you act a certain way, people in the world notice. When you do good deeds, when you love others, people notice. And God gets the glory. Maybe it's something as small as, once again, listening to your roommate tell you about the problems again, or taking extra time to visit a friend who's sick. that you're nothing special, that no one notices or cares. You might think that all the time and attention that you give to your kids is just something that they take for granted. And you know what? Maybe they do. But you are serving as salt and light through the process of their development. Or maybe you wonder about all the time that you take to invest in your marriage. You can certainly get away with a lot less effort. But you are salt and light in your marriage and through your marriage to the whole community. Or maybe you wonder if you're wasting your time mentoring a young employee or coaching. But again, you are the salt and the light for the next generation with consequences that you may never know, at least this side of heaven. So maybe we should not be surprised that God calls us to this remarkable challenge of love. After all, the symbol of the Christian faith is the cross. The cross was an instrument of death. And God chose to give up his son to death on the cross to illustrate and to instruct to us his love. You see, the cross is our ultimate instruction in love. It teaches us that the love of God is our highest good and greatest need, our origin and our end, our first obligation and our paramount duty, and a virtuous habit above every other virtuous habit. One that we should be cultivating the whole of our lives, because it's shaping our character and it is casting our destiny. Love costs us everything, because it means